our reading this morning comes from American poet Robert Frost. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other, just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though, as for that, the passing there had worn them really about the same, and both that morning equally lay in leaves. No step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere, ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference.
Thanks, Jenny, for sharing those special words with us. We'll keep them in mind for today's topic, which is decisions, the power of decision. So decisions, we all make them all day, every day. I suggest that the power of decision is our own. And why are they powerful? Because as we make them, we use them to shape and affect our lives in large and small ways. Some are made in split seconds. Traffic. Some take long and careful consideration of all kinds of factors. Some of yours might not make sense to anyone but you. If I may get personal for a moment, it took months of looking at many couches to finally choose which one to buy. It took only a couple of hours and a cup of coffee to decide on a house. As they say, go figure. We all begin to learn at an early age what kinds of behaviors help us meet our needs. Learning includes a process that some people call trial and error. I really prefer trial and success. After all, deep down, success is what we are after, even if we are not consciously thinking about it. And the error part, let that go. Who wants to keep making the same mistakes? I've thought about decision making for a long time. Our dog, a beagle, would go out into the yard and stop as if he was deciding which way to go first. And I would wonder, what is going on in his head? How does he decide? And then I would wonder, how do I decide? There's so many choices we make every day. Many are by habit, almost unconscious decisions. In the morning, we might ask, how am I feeling? What to do first? What will I wear? What's for breakfast? Do you have a morning routine? Take a moment to think about it. Is it comfortable and familiar? Does it change from day to day or on the weekend? Sometimes how we start our day makes a difference in our attitude and maybe our decision-making process for the rest of the day. Choosing special music to listen to in the morning, having an uplifting thought, or maybe doing something physical might guide us to create a change in perspective. For example, I have a friend who noticed one morning she was feeling really grumpy when she got up that day. The phrase, getting up on the wrong side of the bed, came to mind. So she got back into bed, waited a few moments, and got out on the other side. Now that may seem silly, but I think it was an interesting way of being proactive. It's like saying, there's another interesting way of looking at this, and I'm determined to find it. It also shows that we are the only ones responsible for how we're going to experience or take on the day. Carpe diem. There are so many things that influence our decision-making process. Do we first have to decide to decide? Not deciding is a kind of decision. Think of the critical decision that was made by all the people who didn't make a decision about who to vote for in the 2016 election, but stayed home instead. What if you're considering a decision that will involve a change in your attitude or lifestyle? It's not uncommon to become stuck or sidetracked. A friend was feeling blocked and couldn't finish a big report. And this was the last report she was going to be doing at that job. Someone asked her, "What will happen after it is finished?" She suddenly realized she was stalling, so she wouldn't have to face the next big step in her life, which was selling her home and moving away. Discussion with a friend or counselor can be very helpful, especially if you have someone who will just listen and not offer unsolicited advice. Perhaps you are such a friend to others. What about passively letting others decide for you? Then the blame for something going wrong can be placed on others. Yes, that is called passing the buck. It's a way to avoid ownership for decisions and for your life. We've developed some pretty creative excuses for doing this. The devil made me do it. If you can name your excuses, you already have a great handle on taking charge. I would have, but, or if only. You might ask, who am I making this decision for? Is it for the good of others more than me? And is it being made only by me? Or is there an authority figure from our past that lurks in our subconscious? A parent, a teacher, perhaps our religious upbringing, we might still be rebelling against it. If we can identify it, or him, or her, perhaps we can release it with a statement such as, thanks, or thanks a lot, for your past guidance, for better or worse, but now I'm ready to move forward on my own. Helpful guides may include life lessons from past experiences, logic, inner feelings, friends, or popular fresh ideas. A current author, Marie Kondo, if you've heard of her, do this, Marie Kondo, has sold millions of books, and her suggestions about making decisions have helped people declutter and become more organized. Sometimes we can identify a tipping point where a decision to do something becomes easier. What motivates you to action? If I'm going to have guests, cleaning the house and getting ready for a company is a breeze. And then I benefit by having a cleaner house. What a great feeling. Planning for the future might mean letting go of some of the past. Might it help to choose a new motto or personal theme? It could be a meaningful phrase, a song title, a line from a story or a movie or a poem. If you choose wisely, it could be more powerful than a New Year's resolution. Here at Davies, we have a theme of the month that flavors sermons and discussions and challenges us to think more broadly. Some examples might include open-mindedness, journey, wholeness, possibility. Now here's a personal question. Do you talk to yourself? Say your new motto out loud. I love the words my sister-in-law and her business partner used when things seemed overwhelming in their florist shop. They would get together and say together, "We can do it. We can do it." They used feelings, words, and motion. I have used their slogan, "I can do it." Yes, we can be our own best cheerleaders. The power of decision is our own. Here are just a few other tools to consider using. Step back and come back at a different angle, such as, is there another way of looking at or thinking about this? Ask yourself, what is really going on? Maybe say your name, change your voice, and ask again, what is really going on with this decision? You know, you have to get a little, goofy sometimes. Sleep on it. Ask your subconscious part as you're going to sleep for a solution to come during sleep, and maybe it will be more clear in the morning. How about this old one? Flip a coin and then see how you feel about what comes up. Or talk to a listening friend, or say the word help. Or, I could use some help, out loud when you need it, even if you are all alone, especially if you're all alone. And you're hungry, you go to the refrigerator, and you're standing and standing in front of the fridge. Tell yourself, I must choose food. Then humor yourself and ask, hey, if I did know what to decide, what would it be? And if you've had a mentor, someone you really looked up to, ask yourself, what would that person do? And we can ask other questions of ourselves. They might be casual or directed to that deeper part of ourselves that knows more than we are consciously aware of. Questions could be written, leaving space for answers. They could be asked during a quiet or meditative time or on a walk. Some generic examples might include, what is in my best interest? What is my heart's desire? Does this sound selfish? I believe that what is truly in your best interest, that of your whole self, will be in the best interest of others. We've all heard about how practicing helps us develop a habit. I value this old saying, first we make our habits, and then our habits make us. First we make our habits, and then they make us. A habit that serves us well may be like a friend who stays with us in time of need. We need to be patient. Habit building takes time. One way to create a new habit, such as a path to more happiness, and who doesn't want that, can begin with the way we start our day. So thinking again about your morning, do you already have an affirmation you like? It might be as simple as, today I want to have a good day. Some people think their affirmations. Some say them out loud, post them up on notes around the house, or even include physical motions. I can do it. A positive phrase might sprinkle the day ahead with light, like a breath of fresh air. And as the day progresses and we will forget, we can use our affirmation to start again and again in that earlier attitude, right where we are. We don't have to wait until the next morning to start over. Often we can tell when we are on track, on the better path, by how we feel. Half-hearted or wholehearted. Our doubting and limiting ego self, that judgmental part, may cause us to feel discouraged or half-hearted. Our supportive higher self, the part that knows we are of worth, guides us to feeling more joy and peace, wholehearted. Once we begin to see how that works and how it feels to recognize these two states, we can more consciously choose between them. I mentioned earlier the concept of wanting what is in your best interest, as if it sounded a little selfish. Some of our decisions may seem just like they are just for ourselves alone, but many can affect our whole state of being. That includes how we feel about ourselves, especially as we relate to others. I really like this quote from Oprah Winfrey when she says, "You are responsible for the kind of energy you bring anywhere." I'm responsible for the kind of energy I bring anywhere. This feels like, what version of myself am I sharing with the world? So, responsible, not responsible. Well, for example, I don't go to the grocery store in my pajamas. Not responsible. I try not to go to the grocery store or anywhere in a bad mood. Responsible. Or try not to think of anyone else while I'm in a bad mood. Responsible. I have a lot of oops times, sometimes many times a day, but through practice, deciding to practice, through habit building, by trial and error, or better, by trial and
success.
I'm working toward recognizing when I need to stop and choose to have a better attitude, to tell myself, there is another way of looking at this. I could see peace instead of this. A negative mood or attitude is not in my best interest, nor is extending it toward anyone else, anyone I'm in contact with or thinking about. And thankfully, those times are becoming shorter. You, or as they say in Texas, all y'all, you have my permission to help me practice this here. And I trust you will do it in a good way. Now to quote Barack Obama, It's only when you hitch your wagon to something larger than yourself that you realize your true potential. One of the reasons I have made the decision to hitch my wagon to Davies UU and believe Davies is such a special place is here we can safely explore all kinds of ideas. We can build better habits and learn to practice the kinds of thinking and behavior that is helpful to ourselves and to others. The open hearts and open minds of this congregation are gifts I have accepted. Sometimes, if I am challenged or uncertain, it takes a while to recognize the gifts. That's okay too. But for now, I must say to Davies and to all of you, I wish you all the best decisions. Thank you.